Father, we would glorify you. We would exalt your name because you are great and kind and good and gentle and merciful and just. And in you is life, and that life is our hope. And so we praise you this day as we invite you, Holy Spirit, to come and to minister to us, to change our hearts and our minds and the work of our hands, that in all things we might glorify Christ. We praise you for this day, and we offer ourselves now, inviting you to come and do your work of love in the midst of your children who eagerly seek your face. And we thank you for the privilege in Jesus' name. Amen. Let us draw near to his throne of grace that we may confess our sins and receive his gracious forgiveness. Almighty God, who art rich in mercy to all those who call upon thee, hear us as we come to thee humbly, confessing our sins and transgressions, and imploring thy mercy and forgiveness. We have broken thy holy laws by our deeds and by our words, and by our sinful affections of our hearts. We confess before thee our disobedience and ingratitude, our pride and our willfulness, and all of our failures and shortcomings toward thee and toward our fellow man. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father, and of thy great goodness, grant that we may hereafter serve and please thee in newness of life through the merit and mediation of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Lord, have mercy upon us. Christ, have mercy upon us.
Christ, have mercy upon us.
Lord, have mercy upon us.
Lord, have mercy upon us.
This is good news, that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him might not perish, but have everlasting life. The awesome gift of grace. Praise ye the Lord.
The Lord's name be praised.
May the peace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Thank you. worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our God, our Maker, for He is our God, and we are the people of His pasture, and the sheep of His hand.
Be seated. Our testimony this morning comes from Robin Cook. She was scheduled to be here, but then because of the holiday, she had an invitation, and so she took that. And but she does share this of God's activity in her life. When my dad was very sick back in 1998, he was admitted into Royal Oak, Beaumont. I lived in Bloomfield Township, and I don't drive, but I was able to take a cab to visit with him often. Then he was transferred to Henry Ford downriver. I wasn't able to see him as often, which was sad to me. Neighbors offered to drive me, which was so nice, but I didn't want to be too much of a burden. I was very close to my dad. Cindy, my sister, and her friend Kathy knew that this was a very difficult time for me. They would bring me dinners and go shopping for me. They brought me Thanksgiving dinner and had me over on Christmas. That was a blessing. The thought of losing my dad was so devastating to me that my brothers and sister would constantly reassure me that they love me and everything will be okay. My dad's health was declining and my brother was with him, and he thought I should be there. Kathy drove me downriver, which I am so thankful for to this day. I was able to be there and see my dad right after the Lord took him home, which brought me comfort. I am so thankful to all the people God provided for me through this difficult time. Sometimes people don't even realize how much they make a difference when they help others. Praise God. Let us draw near to the Lord in prayer. Gracious God, our Father, on this holiday, as we remember and celebrate the magnificent work of your children who sought to establish a city on a hill in a new world, and who took all of their life at risk to leave the comfort of what was known and to venture into the unknown, that they might follow your lead to create a new nation that would honor you and that would live in fellowship with you in righteousness and peace. And after 2 centuries, it became difficult. And so the leaders made a break with the past, and independence was sought for this new nation. And we remember that and celebrate that at the root of who we are as the United States of America, there is the recognition that all men are created equal and are endowed by their Creator with inalienable rights. And Lord, we celebrate that and we remember that. And we ask, Father, that you would strengthen this nation that we might never forget our Creator, His purpose, and the privilege that we have to try to embody that in a commonwealth that is available for all, and that is a place of hope and peace and joy. Help us to be faithful in doing our part, that we might accomplish that day by day in every aspect of our lives as well. We're mindful, Lord, that you have given us the privilege of intercession. And so we pray this day for the Holy Church of Christ, that it might be filled with truth and love and be found without fault at the day of your coming. We pray for all pastors, elders, deacons, and other ministers, and for all your holy people. We pray for all who fear you and who believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, that all divisions may cease and that all may be one as you and Father, Son, and Holy Spirit are one. We pray for the mission of your church, that in faithful witness it may preach the gospel to the ends of the earth. And we pray for those who do not yet believe, and for those who have lost their faith, that both might receive the light of your gospel afresh and anew and powerfully, and it may transform their lives in every way. We pray for peace throughout the world, and that a spirit of respect and forbearance may grow among nations and people. We pray for all those in positions of public trust, and we ask that they may serve and promote the dignity and freedom of every person. We pray for all who live and work in this community. We pray for a protection from the disease. We pray for a reestablishment of the economy. And we pray that we might exemplify in our gracious civility all that you have called us to be as your children. We ask also, Lord, that you would bless all human labor and for the right use of the riches of creation, that the world may be freed from poverty, famine, and disaster. We're particularly mindful at this time, Lord, of those who are poor, who are persecuted, who are sick and who suffer. And so we ask your mercy for all refugees and prisoners and all those who are in danger, that they may be relieved and protected. Lord, we thank you for your grace to this congregation, and we ask that you would strengthen us day by day, that we might live a life that is truly honoring to Jesus Christ. We ask that we may be delivered from all hardness of heart, and that we might show forth your glory in what we do, in what we say, and in what we hope for. Father, we would remember also our enemies and those who wish us harm, and for all who have injured us and offended us. And by your grace and power, we ask, Lord, that you would bless and that you would change them and that you would comfort them and that we might be reconciled for the glory of your name. And even now, Lord, as we pray for the forgiveness of our own sins and for the grace of your Holy Spirit to amend our lives, we thank you that you hear our prayers and that you provide for us. And so into your grace, we commit specifically, Father, these loved ones, for Doris, for Dave and Sue, for Bill and Linda, for Sally, for Jen, for the Tucker, for Howard, for Comfort, for the Meadows family, and for the Coche family. And we pray, Lord, that you would be glorified in each of their lives day by day. And now, Father, we ask that you would hear us as we say together the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation,
but deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom,
and the power,
and the glory forever.
Amen.
Quick announcement, next Sunday following worship, we will have a congregational meeting to approve the expenditure of about $24,000 for refurbishing the concrete on the front porch and steps. In the bulletin, in the material that was sent out with the bulletin, there is a more complete explanation of the process, but we have been working at this and looking for this for more than 3 years. We have struggled to find a contractor at a price that we thought was reasonable. We have finally found one. We're still looking at the possibility of a second, but we'd like to go forward with what we have in hand because of the long delay in getting that repair work done to the concrete. So next Sunday following worship, a meeting to approve that. And this is a news to you, then look at the email that your bulletin was in. It is an attachment to that as well. We offer to the Lord our tithes, gifts, and offerings, the expression of our faith and our hope and our love. And God has richly blessed us incredibly with the ability to be faithful stewards. And so in that, we thank him and we praise him as we offer to him our tithes, gifts, and offerings. Thank you, O God, our Father, that your provision is always sufficient, and you have blessed us. And in response to your amazing generosity, we offer to you our tithes, gifts, and offerings that are the expression of our love and our devotion to Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. The scripture lesson for today from the Old Testament is from the book of Psalms. It's chapter 78, verses 17 through 31, and it's printed in your bulletin as well. Yet they sinned still more against him, rebelling against the Most High in the desert. They tested God in their heart by demanding the food they craved. They spoke against God, saying, "Can God spread a table in the wilderness? He struck the rock so that water gushed out and streams overflowed. Can he also give bread or provide meat for his people? Therefore, when the Lord heard, he was full of wrath. A fire was kindled against Jacob. His anger rose against Israel, because they did not believe in God and did not trust his saving power. Yet he commanded the skies above and opened the doors of heaven, and he rained down on them manna to eat and gave them the grain of heaven. Man ate of the bread of the angels. He sent them food in abundance. He caused the east wind to blow in the heavens, and by his power he led out the south wind. He rained meat on them like dust, winged birds like the sand of the seas. He let them fall in the midst of their camp, all around their dwellings. And they ate and were well filled, for he gave them what they craved. But before they had satisfied their craving, while the food was still in their mouths, the anger of God rose against them, and he killed the strongest of them and laid low the young men of Israel. The New Testament reading is from the book of Acts, chapter 5, verses 1 through 11. But a man named Ananias, and his wife Sapphira sold a piece of property, and with his wife's knowledge, he kept back for himself some of the proceeds, and brought only a part of it and laid it at the apostles' feet. But Peter said, "Ananias, why has Satan filled your heart to lie to the Holy Spirit and to keep back for yourself part of the proceeds of the land? While it remained unsold, did it not remain your own? And after it was sold, was it not at your disposal? Why is it that you have contrived this deed in your heart? You have not lied to man, but to God." When Ananias heard these words, he fell down and breathed his last. And great fear came upon all who heard of it. The young men rose and wrapped him up and carried him out and buried him. After an interval of about 3 hours, his wife came in, not knowing what had happened. And Peter said to her, "Tell me whether you sold the land for so much." And she said, "Yes, for so much." But Peter said to her, "How is it that you have agreed together to test the Spirit of the Lord? Behold, the feet of those who have buried your husband are at the door, and they will carry you out." Immediately she fell down at his feet and breathed her last. When the young men came in, they found her dead, and they carried her out and buried her beside her husband. And great fear came upon the whole church and upon all who heard of these things. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
If you'd like to rise and join me in the response of faith.
Therefore
since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Through him we have also obtained access by faith into this grace in which we stand, and we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. Not only that, but we rejoice in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us.
Sweet, near to the heart of God. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, today we rely on the promise of life abundant through your Son, Jesus. We ask that you would send the Holy Spirit to guide our pastor as he speaks your words of truth, and that we would have open and contrite hearts to receive them. We thank you for the opportunity to gather together to learn about a life of following you, and we pray this day we would lay down our past at your feet and pick up our cross to follow Jesus. We pray this in his matchless name. Amen.
This is a first. God called me to proclaim good news 35 years ago, and this is the first time in 35 years that on the first Sunday of July I have preached. God is faithful, and I thank him for the privilege of serving him. Things were going pretty well in the church in Jerusalem. Pentecost had occurred. The witnessing, the work that the church was doing was bearing incredible fruit. Numbers that were being added to the church were incredible. Signs and wonders were being accomplished day by day. The church was devoted to the apostles' teaching, to the breaking of bread, to fellowship, and to prayer. And God blessed it, and it had a major impact on everyone in Jerusalem. Church was richly blessed, growing, vibrant, healthy, exciting, impressive, everything that anyone could possibly want. And so two of the church members decide we're going to participate. And so they sold some property. And I guess I ought to get to my slide, shouldn't I? Things were going pretty good in the church. They had everything in common, lived life together. So Ananias and Sapphira decided, well, we're going to sell some property. We're going to give to the church. We're going to be active participants in the work of ministry. So they sold some property. They come and they put their offering at the feet of the apostles. And Peter says to Ananias, why? Why? Why are you lying to the Holy Spirit? It was yours. You didn't have to sell. You didn't have to bring. You didn't have to contribute. Why are you lying? What is it that's in your heart that has tempted you to this? Why is it that you have contrived this deed in your heart? You have not lied to man, but to God. And Ananias died at that moment. So they carried him out. And 3 hours later, his wife comes, and she says, wow. Peter says to her, how much did you sell the property for? So much, and she says, yes. And Peter says, why did you participate in this lie, in this testing of God? It was all yours. You didn't have anything. There was no pressure on you. The feet of the men who have just buried your husband are at the door. She fell down and died. They carried her out and buried her. And great fear. Great fear came upon the entire church and upon all in Jerusalem. The visible manifestation of God's presence and power created great fear. The center verse that I want to look at is verse 9. Peter said to her, "How is it that you have agreed together to test the Spirit of the Lord? Behold, the feet of those who have buried your husband are at the door, and they will carry you out." Now, it is my practice in preparing sermons to go through, to take the text, to do a whole lot of work in the text, and as you are well aware, with the words and lexicology and all the rest of that, and then I create an outline and put the whole thing together and then create a sermon. And after I'm done, then I go back and I look at commentaries. And commentaries are scholarly treatises by theologians and experts, and they are explanatory of the text. Their use is that they're scholars and they unpack and they go very deeply into all of the nuances that the Greek and the Hebrew and that church history and that church fathers have all put together to create a broader and much more profound understanding of what the text says. So I put this together and then I go back and I open the commentaries, and the first three commentaries that I look at all start the same way. This is one of the most complicated passages in all of the New Testament. All three start with the same sentence. Different authors, different genre, different mindset, but all three of them come back with the same thing. And you know me, I go, did I miss something? Was I not paying attention? So as I start to read the commentaries, to look at the whole thing, they start picking everything apart. And they start arguing about everything that is there. And I'm just overwhelmed with what they see as significant. Let me just give you one example of that. The issue of having to give to the church. And all of them see that as a mandate. Now, you understand that in Acts 2, and again in Acts 4, it says that the church had everything in common, and they sold their goods, and they gave to the church as any has need. Most of the commentators say, well, that means that you had to sell. Now, my problem is, when I read the text, I don't see that. It says that they did what they needed to do with their property to fulfill the ministry that the church was engaged in. And so when you come to Ananias and Sapphira, they didn't have to do anything. But all of my brothers and sisters seemed to think that they were under a significant compulsion. Anyway, that's a sidelight that may be of interest to you, but it stunned me. Here's my summary. I want to look at the visible, the invisible, how about that, and the consequence. So the visible, a man named Ananias with his wife Sapphira sold a piece of property. Pretty simple, pretty straightforward. With his wife's knowledge, he kept back for himself some of the proceeds and brought only a part of it and laid it at the apostles' feet. Okay, so husband and wife agree together to give only a portion to the church. Bring it to the apostles' feet. Now, again, so you don't forget the context, back up to Acts 2, verses 44 and 45. All who believed were together, had all things in common, And they were selling their possessions and belonging and distributing the proceeds to all as any had need. Now, I'm sorry, as I said a moment ago, I don't see compulsion in those two verses. I don't see that they had to do that. I see that they did that because God put a burden on their heart, but I don't see that it was either expected or that it was necessitated. But this is the context in which Ananias and Sapphira want to participate. And so they're going to do what the church is doing. They are going to be engaged in the life of the church. So they sell the property and they bring it in and they lay it at the apostles' feet. Now, one of the things about church life is that most of the time there are no secrets. Most of the time people know what's going on. And particularly if you're paying attention, you see, you hear, you pay attention. And so the church would see Ananias and Sapphira bringing their gift and laying it at the apostles' feet. I don't think it was done in private. I don't think it was done in secret. I think it was part of church life, just as we present our tithes, gifts, and offerings. So Ananias and Sapphira did the same thing. And here's the beginning of the issue. Matthew 6 says, "When you give to the needy, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your giving may be in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you." First principle here about the visible. What we do for the Lord, we do for Him, not to earn brownie points with those who see us. What you do for God, you do for Him and Him alone. But if you are doing it so that others will see your good deeds, you've got a problem. Matthew 23, 4 and 6 says, "They," speaking of the Pharisees, "they tie up heavy burdens hard to bear and lay them on people's shoulders, but they themselves are not willing to move them with their finger. They do all their deeds," ready, "to be seen by others. For they make their phylacteries broad and their fringes long, and they love the place of honor at feasts and the best seats in the synagogue." The motivation for their faithfulness is that others may see them and be impressed. Now, lest you think that this is something that was simply part of the ancient world, think of how much of what we do is done to be seen by others, is done to be recognized, how much we enjoy the accolade that comes, how much we are looking for the pat on the back for doing our good deed. Don't look at me like you don't know what I'm talking about. We all do it. We want to be recognized, and the more we think the deed is, the bigger we think it is, the bigger ought to be the encouragement, the bigger ought to be the pat on the back, the better the seat in the synagogue. Now, in the old days, in the synagogue, the best seats would have been here. In our day, the best seats are back there. But you see, what we want is we want everybody to know how good a Christian we are, how faithful we are, how dutiful we are, how great is our sacrifice to the Lord. And our hearts long for that. And it's a significant part of belonging to the body of Christ. There's a second part, because this is the root of the problem. It's not so much what Ananias and Sapphira did, it's why they did it. And verse 3 of chapter 5 says, "Peter said to Ananias, Why has Satan filled your heart to lie to the Holy Spirit and to keep back for yourself part of the proceeds of the land? See, Peter isn't concerned with the visible. That's not the issue. The issue is that Ananias has come into the presence of God and has lied to the Holy Spirit. That Ananias is not being truthful to God, regardless of what he does with the brothers and sisters of the synagogue. Again, verse 9. Peter said to her, to Sapphira, "How is it that you have agreed together to test the Spirit of the Lord? Behold, the feet of those who have buried your husband are at the door, and they will carry you out." The parerizo, to test, to try, to attempt, to prove, to tempt, to put to the test, to entice to sin, is the Greek. And it describes the act of testing people or the act of attempting. See, the issue here, the crux of this whole story, is that Ananias and Sapphira came into the presence of God and tested him to his face. They came before the children of God, and they outright lied. Again, you know, Peter said to them, "Hey, look, this was yours. You didn't have to do anything. The land was yours. You kept it. And when you gave what you gave, no one asked you to give it all. But when asked the question, 'Is this all?' you lied. You were not truthful in that moment." Beloved, maybe the most important of all of the lessons in this, 1 Samuel chapter 16, the Lord said to Samuel, "Do not look on his appearance or on the height of his stature, because I have rejected him. For the Lord sees not as man sees. Man looks on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart." God sees our invisible intention. And God understands with absolute clarity what it is that is motivating you and me to do any of the things that we do. We can pretend, we can create a smokescreen to deny it, but God sees to the essence of our heart. Paul says in Romans 2, "But a Jew is one inwardly, and circumcision is a matter of the heart, by the Spirit, not by the letter. His praise is not from man, but from God." Isaiah 59, 12, and 13. "For our transgressions are multiplied before you, and our sins testify against us. For our transgressions are with us, and we know our iniquities." Transgressing and denying the Lord. Turning back from the following our God, speaking oppression and revolt, conceiving and uttering from the heart lying words. All through Scripture, the same challenge and the same problem. Because Jesus said in Matthew 15, from our heart flows what comes out of our mouth, and that's what defiles us. What comes out of the mouth proceeds from the heart, and this defiles. It's not the visible that is so often the problem. It's the invisible. There's a consequence to challenging God. A serious consequence. Verse 5 and 6, when Ananias heard these words, he fell down and breathed his last, and great fear came upon all who heard of it. The young men rose and wrapped him up and carried him out and buried him. Now, many of the commentators raise the question, well, wait a minute, Ananias didn't have a chance to repent. So that makes this a difficult text. Well, beloved, here's my problem with that issue. Ananias is actually standing before God. He lies. Ananias is actually in the presence of God, and he lies. We're not talking about Ananias doing something, you know, off and God hearing about it down the road. He's standing face to face, and he lies. Why wouldn't the blasphemer die on the spot? Verse 10, immediately she fell down at his feet and breathed her last. When the young man came, they found her dead, and they carried her out and buried her beside her husband. Now, one of the issues that the commentators raise is this. Well, Peter killed them. Peter didn't kill them. Peter didn't call down death upon them. He warned her of what was going to happen. But all he did was announce. Great fear, verse 11, came upon the whole church. Amen. And rightly so. And upon all who heard of these things. Amen. Rightly so. To me, one of the great issues of our day is that we don't take God seriously. We have this view of God as this benign grandfather somewhere in space who is impotent and unable to do the things that he wants to do, unable to protect, unable to keep, unable to accomplish all of this. I think it's blasphemy. I think God is truly and realistically present in the midst of his people. And we need to be seriously aware of his presence and what he calls us to be. Because none of us knows at that moment when he is going to call us to account. Lying to God will bring death. Lying to God will bring the end of this earthly existence. And beloved, that is a fact that you need to take to the bank. You lie to God, you intentionally mislead him, and you are in serious, serious danger. Now, oh, but God is love, and God wants everyone to repent, and God is unwilling that any should perish. Yes, all that is true. All that is real, but beloved, when you stand in the face of God and blaspheme, I'm suggesting to you, you better be prepared for death. You better be prepared for the consequence of challenging God. The consequence, one of the consequences after death is great fear. Amen. When you see the hand of Almighty God, it ought to cause you to be afraid. It ought to cause you to be deeply concerned. That's the beginning of wisdom. Deuteronomy sets out what I believe to be one of the real summations, the challenges of our life. Moses says to the people of Israel, "See, I have set before you today life and good, death and evil. If you obey the commandments of the Lord your God that I command you today, by loving the Lord your God and walking in his ways and by keeping his commandments and his statutes and his rules, then you shall live and multiply. And the Lord your God will bless you in the land you are entering to take possession of it." Awesome promise. If you walk in agreement with God, he will bless you and you'll multiply and you'll live and rejoice. But, if your heart turns away and you will not hear, but are drawn away to worship other gods and serve them, I declare to you today that you shall surely perish, aka die. You shall not live long in the land that you are going over the Jordan to enter and possess. Now, here's the issue. Pretty clear in my estimation. You can live in fellowship and obedience with God, or you can die in rebellion and lies of your own making. And every single one of us has the choice. Moses goes on, "I call heaven and earth to witness against you today. Set before you life and death, blessing and curse. Therefore, choose life. Choose life that you and your offspring may live and flourish." Beloved, that is God's invitation to every human being on earth. He sets before all of us that simple choice. And the choice is, from my heart, I can choose to agree with God. And when I agree with God, I keep his commandments. I walk in his paths. I am provided for by the magnificence of his providence. And I am able to live and to multiply and to be blessed. Or I can choose to do my own thing. I can choose to say to God, "No, God, I'm going to do my way. I'm going to do my thing. And I don't care what you have spoken or said." Now, that choice, seems to me, is pretty clear. I can agree with God, I can lie to God. And the consequence is life and death. And each one of us has the ability to make that choice. What do we do with it? First of all, we need a new heart. Heart replacement. Nicodemus says to Jesus, "You must be born again." Jesus says to Nicodemus, "You must be born again." And at the center, at the beginning of the journey with God, there is rebirth, a new heart. And it's very simple, that the Holy Spirit comes upon God's people and they are born anew. And God puts within us a new heart. Now, you understand that I'm not talking about a physical organ, a muscle that's located in the midst of the chest. In all of the ancient times and in a lot of what we even currently talk about, the heart is the center of our emotion, the center of our decision-making, the things that are most important to us. And so when Scripture talks about the heart, it's not usually referring to a muscle. It's actually referring to what in computerese would be the CPU, the central processing unit, that place where everything gets decided, where all of the pieces of our thoughts and our emotions and of our choices and of our will gets all mixed together and comes to a conclusion. And so we need a new heart. That heart has to be a heart of agreement with God. That heart has to be a heart of love and tenderness and gentleness and humility. And only God can put that in us. You cannot fake it long. Because what's happening is a war. If my heart is contrary to God, my obedience will be short-lived, because I will always want to go back to that place of homeostasis where I'm at peace and at comfort and go back to following my heart. Two, I didn't say head replacement. Head resemblance. And the head resemblance is that we have the privilege of knowing the mind of Christ. You have the privilege and responsibility to understand the mind of Christ. And so we need to fill the empty space between our ears with all that God has spoken. We need to constantly ingest God's word so that we understand how Jesus thinks, what he perceives, what he wants, what his plans are, and how he works all of that in that moment. And you have the privilege of thinking like Jesus. And so in every situation that you're in, you have the opportunity to have the mind of Christ. But it requires the effort of filling up the empty space. I guess it really isn't empty. In all honesty, you have to drive out all of the world. You have to push out all of the lies and all of the falsehoods. Pastor May and I were talking this past week, and we got to a particular point, and the point that he made to me was, our greatest problem as a nation is our lack of truth. And the lack of truth then flows upstream to impact every single decision, every single organization, and most powerfully, families. But when you go back and you peel it and you come down to the base, it is the lack of truth that is so prevalent in our nation and in the world that is the core problem that needs to be addressed. The only way that's addressed is when our head resembles Jesus, when our thought process, when our thinking and our deciding and our understanding is all in accordance and in agreement with his thinking. And the third thing, you have to let go. You have to relax your hands. You know, I use the illustration for ages and ages. I find it wonderfully powerful that they used to trap monkeys by taking a gourd and taking a treat and attaching the treat to the bottom of the gourd. The monkey would come and would stick his hand into the gourd and grab the treat. But the treat was attached to the bottom of the gourd, and he couldn't get it out. And so by holding the gourd, you hold the monkey. All the monkey has to do is let go. But you know what? He never does. And what he's holding on to imprisons him. What are you holding on to? What are you holding on to that holds you in bondage? Because to you it is such an incredibly wonderful treat that you're not willing to let go of it. Power, prestige, status, likes, followers, money, toys. I don't know. That's between you and God. But when we don't let go, we're a prisoner. Because by our own choice, we're held fast to that moment. So, you have to let go. You have to relax. Ananias, coming to do his big thing before the church, all he has to do is let it go. All he has to do is put it all at the feet of the apostles. But no, I'm going to hold. I'm going to hold back whatever it is, that portion, that piece, that thing. Work at letting go. Work at developing the skill of generosity. Generosity of time, generosity of your talent, generosity of your treasures. And it's simply, I'm going to let go. I'm going to give it to God. It's His anyway. And I'm going to simply relax my grip and allow Him to do with it as He chooses. When I get my heart replacement, and when I work to make my head resemble Jesus, and when I develop extraordinary flexibility in my hands so that I can let go, then I'm on the path to choosing life and blessing and fulfillment. When I do those things, I create that opportunity for God to work in my life in a powerful way. The whole story of Ananias and Sapphira is not built on the issue of what the church was doing, the presentation of money, using the money, selling the goods. That's all just detail. The essence of Ananias and Sapphira is the attitude of their heart to God and their lies killed them. Moses says, I set before you life and death. Choose life. Amen.
Without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for.
You may be seated. Hear the words of the institution of the Holy Supper of our Lord Jesus Christ. The Lord Jesus, on the night of his arrest, took bread, and after giving thanks to God, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me." Every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the saving death of the risen Lord until he comes. Whoever therefore eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of profaning the body and blood of the Lord. Let a person examine himself then, and so eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without discerning the body eats and drinks judgment on himself. With thanksgiving, let us offer to God our grateful praise. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right for us to give thanks and praise.
With joy, we praise you, gracious God, for you created heaven and earth, made us in your image, and kept covenant with us even when we fell into sin. We give you thanks for Jesus Christ our Lord, who by his life, death, and resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. Therefore, we join our voices with all the saints and angels and the whole creation to proclaim the glory of your name. Give thanks to God our Father that our Savior Jesus Christ, before he suffered, gave us this memorial of his sacrifice until he comes again. Our Lord, who though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men, and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Therefore, we proclaim our faith as signed and sealed in the sacrament. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Lord our God, send your Holy Spirit so that this bread and cup may be for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. May we and all your saints be united with Christ and remain faithful in hope and love. Gather your whole church, O Lord, into the glory of your kingdom. Amen. The bread that we break is a sharing in the body of Christ.
We who are many are one body, for we all share the same loaf.
The cup for which we give thanks is a sharing in the blood of Christ.
The cup that we drink is our participation in the blood of Christ.
Congregation of Jesus Christ, the Lord has prepared his table for all who love him and trust in him alone for their salvation. All who are truly sorry for their sins and who sincerely believe in the Lord Jesus as their Savior and who desire to live in obedience to him as Lord, all are now invited to come with gladness to the table of the Lord. Come. You should have in your pew the cups prepared. There's a top plastic that pulls off first, and then the foil underneath that over the juice. The body of Christ given for you. Do this in remembrance of him. Take and eat.
Thanks be to God.
the blood of Christ, shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of him. Take and drink.
Thanks be to God.
Praise the Lord, O my soul.
All my inmost being, praise his holy name.
Praise the Lord, O my soul.
And forget not all his benefits.
Who forgives all your sins.
And heals all your diseases.
Who redeems your life from the pit.
And crowns you with love and compassion.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain.
To receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise.
Loving God, we thank you that you have fed us in this sacrament, united us with Christ, and given us a foretaste of the heavenly banquet in your eternal kingdom. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and to work to your praise and glory. For the sake of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Jesus.